Okay, I'm unsure about the video quality here, but I can't get out there and the sun is too hard on my eyes and I really don't want my sunglasses on. This video is just to share my testimony of what God has done for me in my life, praising Him. So all of where I'm saying it is me, because it's my testimony, but it's about what God has done through, or with me. Some may be through, but starts when I was born, actually. The obvious as far as childbirth, but my mother had every sign of miscarriage that there was to have except for one, and oddly enough, state law, who would have known state law could save somebody? Alabama state law, if the if the pregnancy test came back positive, per Alabama state law, the doctor cannot do, I believe the initials are DNC. And that was the only thing that kept me around, is that state law. We're pretty sure there was probably that mom was probably carried twins, but God had a purpose otherwise. And if I'm right, we'll meet my twin when we get to heaven. Past that, when I was about six, I kept pestering and begging mom and dad to take me up front in during a revival. I told them I wanted to get saved. No, I didn't really fully understand everything going on there, but I did know enough that I sincerely wanted to be saved. Mom and dad did everything they could do. They took me to Sunday school teacher, to the preacher, to whoever for counseling. They did exactly what they should have done. I do remember that. The decision was made that I was just too young to understand, and I understand them coming to that conclusion. I really do. But God wasn't done yet. He stayed after me, and I'm literally tugging on Dad's shirt tail, if I remember correct, telling him I wanted to be saved. So he picked me up, carried me down front. We told the evangelist, because it was in a revival, what I wanted, my desire was, and the preacher bent down, talked to me. But I had a little bit going on there, as in I'm a little short 6-year-old and scared of the big, tall adults. Only thing I honestly heard him say, I remember that to this day, I heard a noise. That's all I heard of his voice. And when people came up and were asking me, did I accept Christ? Did I pray? I knew I didn't pray, and I did know enough to know that I needed to pray. But I wasn't going to tell them no. So I told everybody I did get saved. I got baptized. And I feel like the course of events that led on made a mess for me. Lots of confusion. I don't really remember anything in elementary school, and that age range, but middle school and high school, that was a different story. That's good times. I was not a miserable kid, but there was some uncomfort and misery and confusion there, because I'm interacting with and wanting to be friends with folks that were not in church, and I mean, we did fine, but I didn't feel like I fit. I went to church, and I didn't feel like I fit. Accepted in both places. But something was still wrong. Honestly, middle school and high school years, I actually had dreams that the rapture was happening, and I was there with other people saying, well, he's not taking me. And yeah, that'll rattle you in your shoes. Did me. So that went on all through high school, tough year, middle school, high school, it was tough years anyway. Tougher even, and for people in the same boat as me or similar. Thinking you're one thing, but you're not. Convincing you're one thing, in the back of your mind, you know you're not. I knew I wasn't, but most of the time I would talk myself into thinking I was at other times. Didn't like myself a whole lot. I was very, very immature and self-conscious. If somebody argued with me, of course they were right, and of course I was wrong, because they're arguing with me and telling me I was wrong. Even though now, looking back, of course, they didn't have a clue either. Blooming teenagers. At 22 years old, my Uncle Philip, preaching at Whitechapel Baptist Church in Gadsden, Alabama, he said what I needed to hear at the time I needed to hear it, God thing, on a Wednesday night. He said, there's 6 inches between knowing you're lost and becoming a Christian. You've got to know it here, but to get it here, it's got to come through here. You have to pray. You have to ask forgiveness for your sins from Jesus. Let him know that you know you're a sinner and that you want him in your heart. You want to live and serve him. Without that, you will not be saved. That is the only way to Christianity. Jesus is the only way. And I will try to figure out in editing this to figure out how to get the scripture right across the bottom of the screen there. At that point, I let my mother know, she was the first one I saw, that I had been saved. And she had even had some dreams that were basically that all of her family wasn't saved, but she didn't know who, because we thought everybody was. I have not had the dream of being left behind at the rapture since. I absolutely know I am a Christian. I will be in heaven. I will see my twin when I get there, and other loved ones and friends and all that, as that happens. Really, overall, well, I will continue a little bit there. There is a call on me for preaching. I have, in the last 3 or 4 months, it wasn't a fight over that or arguing it. It was, I wanted to be sure that I was being led of God, not driven. I've got back issues, my legs are weak, I've got some things going on, like a whole lot of people do, and a whole lot of people have it a whole lot worse than me. That's not a sob story, it's just with that, I don't know what this conference looks like. Could be evangelistic stuff, I don't know, I ain't got there yet. I do know that's a call, though. That's not in question. Spent a long time praying, reading my Bible, talking to my wife, us praying. She's very supportive. God blessed me with that woman. But looking back, even probably 20 years ago, I can see where this whole thing is weird for me. I'm talking to a camera, technically a tablet, but it's a camera on a tablet. That's just not real. Over the past, I would not be doing this at all. It just seems weird talking to a camera. Talking to a crowd never has been my thing. If I see a crowded room and I can't, I usually turn and go the other way. Now, people person, yes I am, but not crowd. You get one-on-one or small group with me, and everybody that knows me knows I'll talk your ears off. I'll chase a few rabbits and talk circles and working on that, trying to get that better. I'm saying all of that, that part of things, because I know for a fact, you get 20 people in a room, somebody else is going to have some similar worries about their Christian walk, their evangelism, their outreach, talking to people. I never was a reader because I'm very slow in comprehension. And this, I'm not dumb, but I am slow on that comprehension. I have gotten better. God qualifies the called. He does not call the qualified. I promise you, I would not be in a call of a preaching or evangelist or anything there without God's starting to qualify me or qualify whoever, qualify the called. I know there's people out there that have had the same experiences. I was the one in high school that the cool guys, I had an armload of books, big old thick textbooks, about four of them, and got pushed into the girls' bathroom. Books just slid within about 10 feet of them at the counter. And you can just imagine the scene with me, skinny little me, trying to scrap, get my books and get out of there. I took a lot at that point because honestly, I was too scared to fight back. Some of the guys, as we all know, with punks and bullies, and I don't really call that one bullying. That term is overused today. They weren't real nice at that time. I don't know what they are today. Honestly, don't care. If they're good guys, if we come in contact, I'll have no issue there. That was a long time ago. But I'm saying I was that guy. Wouldn't defend myself because, one, I didn't like myself terrible much. It was a roller coaster ride. I had, as everybody else, I had good days and bad days. But don't let that keep you down. Don't let that stop you from seeking God to find out what He has for you. People say they want to find themselves. Well, if you want to find yourself, get in the Word. Read the Bible. Pray. Christian counseling, Christian counsel, just like the Bible says. Let God tell you who you are, because He is the ultimate author. He is the reason you're here. He knew you before He formed you in your mother's womb. And I'll have that scripture on here as soon as I figure out how to do that. If I have to, I'll do a reply on it and type it in that way. I will back up what I'm saying with scripture. Don't be me. Don't wait till you're 55 years old to be solid enough to search and seek and tired of being a pew sitter. I've been in church all my life. That was not an option in my house. I say, Mom, Dad, do I really have to go to church today? When I was younger, what would Jesus do? Well, what are you going to do with that? You drop your shoulder, and go get dressed and get ready for church. And there you go. I was raised in a Christian household, conservative household. Thank the good Lord, quite literally, for that. Mom and Dad, through Jesus, provided our foundation for a Christian life. And I'm trying to instill that in my children as well. And for the record, when I get to talking like that, this is another thing of that God calling, the qualifying the called. Going through some of that stuff about the kids and about my upbringing, this is the very first time I have ever said that at all without tearing up and not being able to talk. God's working. Tried to find a place to fit in church, and I am involved. A matter of how getting involved and where I fit per God's lead. That's the key. Me and my wife just joined the Gideons a few months ago. I highly recommend that for you Christians watching this. Check them out. Can't have too many. Passing out the scripture is fun. I've only been able to do it once so far. There is a Gideon auxiliary, which is where the wives come in. That is an awesome ministry. But don't, another thing I did that, yes, that's not exactly rabbits, but I am all over the place. I do understand that. Don't not do things because you're afraid of failure or because you're afraid of being made fun of or whatever. Some of that teasing is just life, and the good ones, if they're teasing you, it's because they like you. I didn't start hunting. That's just, you know, one thing that I wanted to. Dad, 14 years old, I believe. Mom and Dad gave me a 12-gauge double barrel for Christmas. But at that point, Dad got allergies so bad to outdoors, he couldn't go. I was too bashful to go with anybody but him. And I never started. I love to shoot. You can see my shooting range, semi-sorta, in my backyard. And that was all on me. I could still go, but I've got other things I'm doing right now, and it's not as easy as just grab your gun and go. But point is, there's a lot of things I didn't do because I didn't want to be made fun of, because I didn't want to. It wasn't a perfectionist tendency, I don't believe. It was that fear of being made fun of. The problem with that is, when you're so afraid that you won't start, you think you're in a safe square, a safe box. I thought I was. My biggest regrets are things I did not do, not the things that I didn't mess up on, because I learned. You can't learn when you don't do. Get yourself out there. Put yourself out there. Fail. Fall. Get up. Learn. Laugh about it. Laugh with other people. Spin it. If they make fun of you, spin it and laugh with them. Their opinion, if they're truly on a actual make fun of you, their opinion doesn't count. Doesn't matter. Because they are not uplifting you. They are punching you down, most likely to help lift them up. That's just the way that works. Most of the time people are knocking you and making fun of you is because of something about them, not about you. Don't do that. Don't be me at that point. Don't be like me with so many other. I mean, there's plenty of people around that have done the same thing. Get out there. But seriously, if you want to know what you're made of, go to the one that made you. Go to God. Let Him tell you what you're made of and what His purpose for you here is. You were born in this place, wherever you are, at this time, for a reason, for a purpose, under God, for His glory, to our benefit. We as Christians receive blessings from God as we obey Him within His purpose for our life. That is who you are. Don't lose sight of that. When you go trying to find who you are on your own, our hearts are wishy-washy at best. This week we like this, next week we like another. And that brings in confusion. It can bring in, I mean, me personally, I'd love to be an ace mechanic, build engines, cars, do woodwork as well. I can do the woodwork some degree. I can tinker with the car. That one will probably never come to fruition, and okay. But that's just personal desires on my part. Right now, the only thing that I really have on my head is, where does God want me? Within that, I will be taking care of my wife, my kids, my family, my home. In His timing, His way, His will, His purpose. Put God first, then family, then church, and He will help you take care of everything in proper order. Nothing will go to the wayside. I would love to hear your comments on this. Keep it civil. Keep it polite. Doesn't have to be in agreeing. Matter of fact, when you disagree, that puts me at, when you voice a disagreement, I'll dig in the Bible and find out what the truth is on the subject, and I'll share that back with you. There ain't no point in me arguing on my opinion. My opinion could be wrong too. So let's find out what the Bible says about it, and I'll be glad to get back with you. Any suggestions, any just whatever you have on your head, put it down below in the comments, and I will be glad to read them and reply as I can. That's about it for this video. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. God bless you. I love you, but best of all, God loves you. Seek Him, and life will be complete.